if you're heading into the backcountry, it's just so important that you understand the snowpack as a process. It's always changing. It's getting stronger, it's getting weaker. If you just dig into the snowpack, you can actually see and feel different layers. And the interaction between those layers means everything to slab avalanche formation.
If we take a look at the snowpack, starting from the ground up, we can see what's gone on with the weather from October till whatever time we're at in the season now. I can see areas of weakness that stick out at me, or layers, weak layers that stick out at me. As we see changes in precip, wind, temperatures, we can pick those things out as changes in the snowpack.
Avalanches are typically a certain recipe in the snowpack that has created an interface or an entire layer of snow that just isn't healing or bonding to the other layers.
A slab avalanche needs a bed surface, a weak layer, and then a cohesive overlying slab. And at the end of the day, we've got kind of like the mattress over top of the marbles over top of the concrete floor. And I know that's kind of an exaggerated model, but you get the picture. In general, crystals that are small, tight, and round are strong. There's just more points at which they can touch and bond. If you look at crystals that are large, loose, and irregular, they're weaker crystals. There are just fewer points at which they can touch, and you can see how they have just more leverage over contact points. And weather affects the snowpack in different ways, and a key strengthening process in the snowpack is called rounding. And it happens over time when the temperatures are just a little closer towards zero. And basically, the crystals become, you know, smaller and more round, and they're at a point where they can touch. So, like I said, they get stronger. A weakening process is called faceting, and that's when water vapor gets drawn out of the snowpack due to a temperature gradient. And what happens over time is the crystals become more square-like, they become larger, looser, and more irregular. So that could be potentially, in the long run, a weaker sliding layer. Another crystal we deal with a fair bit is surface hoar. It's often referred to as hoarfrost, and it's basically dew, but the process happens below zero, so what we're left with are feather-like crystals on the surface, and on sunny days, it looks like diamonds as you're riding through the terrain. Those crystals over time become larger, looser, and more regular, and they can be a weak layer.
This is a good shot of surface hoar. These crystals that are growing on the surface are really delicate, and when they get loaded with whatever storm cycle comes next, they're not gonna support much weight, and they'll collapse pretty quick.
So here you can see a classic example of about 10 millimeter surface hoar, and you can see it growing in the old snowmobile tracks. Just goes to show you that even though the area gets ridden a lot, it can still form a bad layer right on top of old tracks.
We deal with crust a fair bit as well, and crust can happen because of wind, because of rain, because of sun, and crusts make bed surfaces, and like I said before, an avalanche needs a bed surface.
We're on a south-facing aspect here with a big, huge melt freeze crust. Sort of this big, thick eggshell with a whole whack load of facets underneath.
So this is the sun crust here. They grow fastest on steep solar aspects, gets a melt freeze on it, cold overnight, and then it deals with something like this. Have a look at that bad boy. So you got it about a centimeter and a half thick. Now this could become our next weak layer if it's buried by 20 to 30 to 40 centimeters of new snow. We cover a lot of terrain on snowmobiles. Everything that we ride, all the aspects, all the elevations, everything's quite different. Just what we find in one little spot like this, one aspect, one elevation, that's going to be different on, as we move over to the next bowl, over to our next favorite riding spot. Spatial variability, it's a term that you're going to hear lots in the bulletins and in through an avalanche course, and it means ever-changing conditions. It's always going to be different out here. As we go around another corner, we should almost expect another snowpack. Have you noticed in here, no crust? We're at a different aspect, different elevation. Got beautiful blower snow here in front of us. So bam, look where we are right now. Spatial variability we talked about. We've covered a lot of terrain. We've been down low in the trees with a thick sun crust. We've been into some north-facing stuff in the shade. We've got some north-facing stuff on the angle behind us there, really steep avalanche terrain. In the background behind us, we've got serious cornice development. We've got wind-loaded stuff. We've got wind-affected terrain. Remember, spatial variability. Things change as we move elevations, aspects, inclines.
We now know how much the snowpack can vary from one slope to another. But different mountain ranges also possess dramatically varying snowpack characteristics. Take the Coast Range. It usually snows a ton and temperatures are typically relatively warm. As a result, the Coast Range sees a lot of storm slab instabilities, but fewer persistent weaknesses than, say, in the Rockies or the Columbia Mountains. In the Rockies, the snowpack can be shallow and temperatures are typically cold. Because of this, temperature gradients in the snowpack promote faceting, and these weaknesses can persist throughout the winter. The Columbia Mountains, smack dab in the middle, seem to possess traits from the coast and the Rockies. Temperatures can be cold, but it still snows a ton, and surface ore loves to grow.
Spatial variability, as we move around from area to area, just because we ride in northern BC on the coast doesn't mean that as we come down to say Fernie, it's going to be the same type of snowpack. These are all things that we should just kind of be aware of and think about as we're heading out to our new destinations.
It's crucial to understand that certain areas on a slope are more likely trigger points. These areas include convex rolls, terrain below cornices, partially buried trees, rocky outcrops, and general areas where the snowpack is thin.
Taking an avalanche course really helps with that stuff. It'll help you gain the knowledge of what are the main clues to look for. Shooting cracks around your skis, recent avalanche activity, high winds, high rates of snow falling, lots of recent precipitation, persistent weak layers. There's a lot of things that we need to look for, so it's really important that we educate ourselves a little bit before we head out here.